Everybody, it is time for Happy Hour with Dr. Lisa. Thank you for joining me. This is volume 21 already. Can you believe it? It is correlating today with blog 11. So blog 11 deals with Teacher Appreciation Week. And there's a reason that I called that Teacher Appreciation Week, and we will talk about that in just a minute. If you want to call in live, you can do so on Podbean. If you just want to leave a message or chat with me, you can do so at area code 765-205-1959. Some of you have tried to call me, and I appreciate it. You have to leave a message. If you don't, then I don't know who you are, and I'll think it's spam, and I hate spam just like all of you, so I won't call you back. So you have to leave me a message or just send me a text message at that number, or if you want to email me, please do so. KidsCanSeeGhosts@gmail.com. One of the other things you can do is you can catch me on social media. My Facebook page is now public, so anybody can access my Facebook page. You can see everything pertaining to this podcast or the blog on my Facebook page, which is just under my name, Lisa Liggins Chambers. And it says at Dr. Lisa 3, which is also a way to access me on Instagram. And also my public page for Instagram is at Kids Can See Ghosts Can You. So you can catch me pretty much anywhere. If you have any questions or comments, somebody actually wrote to me yesterday and talked about how when he was a little boy, he was able to see ghosts. So I like hearing those kind of stories because now more people are opening up about it and even opening it up, toward me. And so it makes me feel good because some people are telling me that now that, you know, I'm talking about it, you know, they feel more open to, you know, discussing some of the things that they've gone through as well. So that is the number one reason why I am telling these stories. I want people to feel more comfortable with talking to, you know, the public about their feelings and things that happened to them. And then I had someone else write to me and tell me that as a kid, it was the same, you know, type of stories like dark angels and, you know, waking up at night and, you know, there'll be a ghost at the end of the bed and, you know, and telling different parents and everything, they felt crazy. And crazy is the word that people use to describe people who can, you know, see different ghosts. And so that's how this person felt. And so when people started to call this person, quote unquote crazy, they stopped telling people. So now that I'm actually pretty vocal about it, this person is starting to talk about it as well. More medical professionals have been reaching out, telling me their stories. I don't know. I'm starting to think most medical professionals can detail a time when they experience paranormal activity in the hospital or, excuse me, hospice or, something in they've heard about, happening to the hospital. Nurses are huge in telling you different things. So I appreciate that kind of information. And if you have one, I would love to hear your story as well. You can talk about it, live on Podbean, Podbean. Okay, so blog 11. So I want you to understand my train of thinking. My line of thinking was always, if I decide to write a book, I want the book, the readers to understand these children from my perspective, from my opinions, from my professional expertise. So there are times when I give you more background about me because it sets you up as a reader or as a listener to understand why I go on, for example, and talk about Child C. Child C is who I am going to talk about next. So blog 11 kind of sets you up for some of the things that Child C would tell to me, tell me over and over again, when I met with that child. Yeah, ABC, Child C should be next. So you also have to excuse me, as you can hear, I'm going through something, allergies or something, and it's really bugging my voice at this point. So I hope you guys can hear me. I'll turn the mic up a little bit. Okay, so to set you up for Child C, who is or was a probably is a phenomenal person, definitely a phenomenal child. I'm gonna tell you some things that happened to me as I grew up in psychology, because I always talk about, how I grew up in psychology. And actually, that is a blog that I am doing right now. My growth or how I grew up in the field. So if you want to jump to that, this last blog was all about growing up in psychology because there is some growing up that you have to do in this field. And just as a sidebar, it's funny because I watch young social workers and young school counselors and young psychologists fresh out of school, freshly licensed, and sometimes I giggle because I remember, being that new young person and feeling some of the things that they go through, right? I'm giggling because somebody said I need a hot toddy. You need a hot toddy? That's true. So maybe I'll do that when I leave this podcast. Good idea. So, when I was first starting in the field, I was really young. The story I'm getting ready to share with you, I may have been 25, so the same age as a social worker that I was working with today. She's so bright. She said, "I'm 25," and I was just giggling because I remember being 25 and being new at this. So the story I'm going to share with you hails out of St. Louis. And it was a time when I was about 25, maybe 26. And then I was new to a school. So I will never forget this school district. And I am going to use the name of this school district outside of St. Louis, north in St. Louis, because this was a phenomenal school district for a lot of reasons. Excuse me. And so this was Riverview School District. That was the first school district that I worked in as a school psychologist. And I had such a great experience with them, from the learning to the teamwork. The kids were wonderful. The atmosphere Everything about that school district was positive, so I will never forget the school district. Now, typically, I don't name school districts or jobs or anything, but that one, if they ever listen to this podcast, I want them to know, back then, I was very grateful. I think this may have been 1997, 98. So, when you think about this school district, I was very new to everything. One of the things that I talk about in this particular blog is not just about this school district, but also about kindness, being kind to people. So when I was in this school district, one of the things that they would do for me is to kind of look out for me being a new school psychologist. So they would kind of cover, if I didn't have something correct, they would talk to me about it. They would help me to understand it. And I had such a great boss back then as well, who taught me a lot about writing, different, educational reports on these kids. And this takes a lot of work and a lot of patience. And you do have to understand how to put these things together, including the data, because you have to be accurate in special education with regard to how you make kids eligible for disabilities. And so they taught me all of that. It was phenomenal. So I found out I was pregnant, which is a whole nother story. And so throughout that pregnancy, and it was my first baby, throughout that pregnancy, the staff was pretty good to me, and supportive. I'll give you an example. One day we were in a team meeting. More than likely, it was what we call a results meeting. And in Illinois, we call those, I'll just give you the acronym, EDC. And so we were in that meeting, and I had a craving for pumpkin seeds. And I left. I said, I have to go get some pumpkin seeds. Some of you gentlemen can't relate to that, but the ladies know what I'm talking about if they've had a baby. It is a craving that hits you like this. So I left before the parent came, went to the gas station. I may have been 6, 7 months pregnant. Went to the gas station. They had a big, I know my former high school classmates will remember those big bags of pumpkin seeds in the red bags. I popped it open in the gas station and I just kept eating it and kept eating it. It was so good, I still remember it. And they didn't even ask me to pay for it in the gas station because they were like, you must be craving it, just go on. I went back to the school and they were just laughing and giggling, because I had to leave to go get some pumpkin seeds. So just different, things like that. And it may sound as if it's just a small thing, but it's not. These things matter to me, and here it is, 20 plus years later, and I still remember this staff. So back then, I used to talk about, so mind you, again, this is back in like, I think I was licensed in January of 98, or maybe December 97, but definitely by January 98, because I started the job there. And so I started talking about these kids because back then, I started meeting nebulous kids. Obviously, back then, I didn't put anything together. So I would talk to the staff, like, whoa, this kid, just told me that, she or he could see ghosts. I don't know what to do with that. I was really young. And what I remember a lot of things about this district, but one of the things that I do remember is that there was never a, anything negative that I can recall that came out of their mouths when I would talk about these kids. So this type of phenomena, it's been happening to me for a long time. And so when you're a school psychologist, you spend a lot of time with kids one-on-one because you are assessing them. So there were a lot of kids that I worked with back then. And so there were quite a few back then who talked about the fact that they could see ghosts. Now, I didn't put it together like I can now. but I took mental note of these things, you know, being told to me. So much so that not only would I tell, you know, the staff about it, but I will also talk to my then husband about it as well. So these are old stories that you guys are just now listening to. So that staff was so kind to me that when it was time for me to have the baby or go on maternity leave, I walked into the school one day, and I will never forget this. Most of them also knew how shocked I was to be pregnant, but that's a different story. They had a baby shower for me at the school, and they gave me all of this stuff for the baby that I will never forget. That was probably my first experience on a job dealing with teachers who were supportive of me, who listened to me, who were kind to me, who helped train me, who helped me believe in special education. So that was my first experience. Now, my love of teachers go back because I had a third grade teacher that I'm still crazy about, and I know she's on my Facebook page, and I'm live on Facebook, but I don't know if she's listening. Her name is Mrs. Hicks. And to this day, I talk to my kids about Mrs. Hicks, but I also talk to the kids that I work with that are third graders. I always tell them about Mrs. Hicks as well. Because like some of you, she was that teacher for me back then. And all these years, I never forgot about her. Although we lost touch back in, I think, 01 after I had the baby. And then I went on to get my doctorate. But I found her a couple years ago with the help of some of my former high school classmates who are still in Ohio who found her. And so my first love of teachers came from my third grade teacher. The next one, the second one, was from one of my high school teachers. Her name is Mrs. Sharp, and she was teaching psychology. So I got into psychology because I can remember sitting in Mrs. Sharp's class, staring at her board, because we had chalkboards. We didn't have computers, but we just started getting computers. So we still had chalkboards. And I remember looking at the chalkboard thinking, this is so cool. This is the coolest thing ever. She's talking about the brain. She's talking about these funny kind of things. I know they're disorders now, but I didn't know back then. And so that sparked my interest in the field of psychology and then working with children when I was in high school. So, you know, Teacher Appreciation Week goes beyond a week for me. This is years of learning from teachers, you know, and then kindness is a big deal to me. And it is now. And I've encountered a lot of people who just aren't kind people. I was talking about a couple of people last year who just weren't kind people toward me. And so when I encounter, you know, so many people, especially doing the podcast, that are just very nice and kind, it means a lot to me. And so when you kind of go through all that over and over again, there's a learning curve, right? And we all have to be appreciative of that learning curve. And unfortunately, I experienced people last year who were not as appreciative of the learning curve. The positive teachers that I've encountered realize that people need room for growth. So even though I told these stories about nebulous children for many years, there have been other professors, such as my professors who trained me as a psychologist, such as other professors who still train me to teach classes, because I'm still on faculty at a university and also at a community college, and they still train me. These are some of the kindest people that I've ever met in my life. So I am who I am because of teachers. So I decided to make this Teacher Appreciation Week, this blog, because I actually wrote it during Teacher Appreciation Week. And so I wanted to all of you to understand, you know, not only how much I appreciate teachers, but support staff, administrators. It's really tough right now being in the school. We have several teachers out right now with COVID. We have a COVID classroom. There are kids in the COVID classroom every day who have to go home. So it's really tough. And it was tough during Teacher Appreciation Week when I wrote this blog. So I wanted, this to kind of be a shout out to teachers, but still sticking along the path of, talking about children that can see ghosts, because one of the other big things surrounding my learning curve was talking to the majority of these teachers about what I was going to do with these kids who can see ghosts. Yep. So I told a lot of them about this. So here's some of the advice that a lot of the teachers gave to me about this. So, excuse me, some of them told me to keep it to myself because the world is cruel. The world is cruel. So they said, keep it to yourself because society won't accept this from you. There were a lot of reasons they told me that. One, being African American. Two, they don't believe in it. And three, and it probably prevented me from talking about it for a long time, that nobody cared. But see, I appreciate think about why I want to share this kind of information with the public. So for a long time, I didn't know why I wanted to share this information. And then I spoke to a couple of other, of my colleagues, my best friend, and a couple of other, teachers in the schools who said, "Hey, I hear kids talking about they see ghosts all the time." And then I experienced one, earlier this year, and I said, "Okay, now it's time." So teachers have influenced me in a couple of ways along this journey. And so one of the biggest ways is always making me think, not jump, but think. So I sat and I thought about it. I probably thought about it too long. I mean, 20 years is a long time, but I had to figure out how I wanted to share it with, the public. And so I talked to some, another teacher earlier this year who said, "You are a storyteller. You have a lot of stories to tell. I need you to put this out there because my kid can see ghosts. My kid can see ghosts." And I thought, wow, okay, so you're telling me that your kid can see ghosts. What's your story? And I'll tell you the story. The story is that this child would not sleep at night. This child was constantly in the room with this teacher or who the mother. This child was afraid of the dark. This child kept talking about there were ghosts at the edge of the bed. There were ghosts in the hallway. There were ghosts in the basement. There were ghosts outside. This kid saw ghosts everywhere, according to this teacher. And I don't know how to help my child. I don't know how to help my child get through this. I am up all night. I am crying because I'm helpless. I am sad because I don't understand, because I don't see what this kid, my kid, sees. So when that teacher shared that with me, that story, and there were more details to it, I helped that teacher create a plan to unravel, if you will, her own sadness so that we can get to the bottom of what was happening with her child. I hope that makes sense. And so once we dealt with, and she was not my client, this teacher was a colleague of mine. I don't see adults, keep that in mind. So when we began, it just kind of, I'm a type of person who will either bullet point, everybody who knows me knows this, I will bullet point my writing, or I'll actually draw it out. Excuse me. So for this teacher, I drew it out. I actually had, there are a couple of things I do. I had her take her sadness and kind of divide it up in different categories and figure out from those categories how to bridge them all together to make her feel better, because what I wanted to do is to help her to understand that it's normal. You know, a lot of parents just don't know what to do. Guys, this stuff is scary to these kids. A lot of it is really scary. So if you are watching your kid in horror all the time, it does something to your psyche. So for a lot of people, when I work with them, I always talk to them and tell them, hey, normalize how you feel. Feelings are great. We all have them. Normalize it. You know, I have kids. If they were in horror all the time, I would probably break down too, because I don't know what to do. Or I wouldn't know what to do. And that's how they feel. They don't know what to do. So she didn't know what to do. So after we kind of got through her feelings and started to empower her and make her feel better, I told her she could do it. You know, she can go in and help her child learn to control the ability to see ghosts. And you know what this teacher did? She took that information and she toughened herself up and she cried when she needed to. But she went and she started helping her child get through this. One of the first things that she did was she started to teach her child how to control what's being seen. What that means is, if you talk to anybody, especially an adult who can see ghosts, they'll tell you they don't have to deal with ghosts that they don't want to see. And that's one of the first things that I do when I train kids, or I train parents to teach their kids and to help them. They don't have to see these things if they don't want to. So for example, if there's a dark angel around, other parents that talk that can see ghosts, some nebulous parents have said, there are dark angels around, I don't want to see them. So I tell them to go away, or I do it in prayer in God's name, and then they don't have a choice but to go away. So that's what these parents do. And those are some of the things that the parents taught me that I taught to this teacher. Actually, I told a professor this. Was today Wednesday? Maybe Thursday? Last Thursday? Some of the same things, because another one said that their kid can see ghosts. So that's what this teacher did. So I gave her back the kindness that she bestowed upon me. And it felt really good to do that. So, you know, this particular teacher helped me get through a learning curve last year. Last year was a rough year, working year for me, for a lot of reasons. And so there were some teachers in the background who were my salvation. Let me just say that, other than the social worker that I now call my best friend. So these teachers within my life have been instrumental in helping me. So now I give it back to teachers that need it. And so this teacher, actually, I'll just give you a little update, because I talked to her recently, and she feels a lot better. Her child is sleeping a lot better. Some nights are a little more rough, but she is reminding her child what should be done in order to control his or her gift. And it's working. It's working. This child feels a bit more empowered, because some of the kids don't realize that they can, when they do talk to these ghosts, that they can be demanding, like they have power. So some of the kids feel like they're Superman or, you know, Wonder Woman when they learn about these things that they can do, right? And so that's what's happening to her kid. You know, it's kind of like I put on my Superman or Wonder Woman cape, and then I can say, go away. And if they don't go away, they know how to make them go away biblically. And so it's been an experience for her. One of the things she said is that she didn't have anybody to talk to. Like a lot of her family would tell her that her kid is crazy, right? And a lot of her family would dismiss her feelings about what was happening to her child, but not me, not me. And I hope you don't dismiss people like that either. So even if you don't want to hear it, we all have to express some kind of empathy, right? So what I gave to this teacher is what other teachers have given to me, and that's empathy. Empathy. Empathy is missing sometimes. Let me give you an example, a personal one. So I have been a school psych in Missouri. This was very clear last year that I was a school psych for many years, since 1998 in Missouri. In 2001, I left Missouri and went to go get my doctorate up in Chicago. You guys know that. I stayed in Illinois for a very long time, moved back to Missouri, and then we just came back to Illinois last year. So without, you know, going into detail, you already know that the adjustment would be hard. Why? Because paperwork is different. The names of meetings are different. Things are different. You're also new to an area and you have to adjust. That was very clear last year. There were so many people last year who were not kind toward me. So what does that do to someone? Well, it pisses you off. And then you start getting unkind back, which is what happened to me. And I can cut deep verbally if I have to. Toot my own horn. But I didn't. Last year, I worked for 5 months in one place, not being the psychologist that I've been trained to be, because there were a lot of unkind people who were completely unfair to me and racist. But I made them deal with me. I didn't resign. I let them deal with me. And you know what? Other than a supportive social worker, there was one teacher who called me and said, make them deal with you for 5 months. Don't resign. Because I had other job offers on the table and I was going to go. But I decided to stay because a teacher and a social worker said to me, no, stay. You stay. Make them deal with you every day. If they don't like the color of your skin, make them deal with it. So there we have another teacher who I can never reveal who that teacher is, but told me, let them deal with you. And I did. And they paid me all last summer, too. So, there you go. There was a teacher who, instead of allowing me to feed into my emotion, because things like that make you angry. Yeah, I'm a psychologist, but we have emotions too, and I was pissed. Ooh, I was pissed off. And she said, no. That's not what we do. This is what we do. This is how. If they didn't understand, that you weren't going to know everything because you were from out of state, that's their fault because you disclose it. You stay and you make them deal with you. And I did. And so this year, when the job ended, that same teacher came to me, and that teacher put that teacher's hand on my shoulder and said, "I knew you could do it. Even though they treated you badly, I knew you can do it." And what happened? Not only did you do it, not only are they going to pay you, but you're stronger and you have a better job. Now I'm going to talk to you about this podcast because I have a kid that can see ghosts. Then another person said to me, that same day, shortly afterwards, and this person had also talked to me about a week prior, has said, "I used to be with patients in nursing homes who would talk to something in the room right before they passed away." Yep. So here you have, there were three people who guided me and told me what to do. Two had stories about the paranormal, one about a child, the other one about, a nursing home, which opened up to me talking to my friend, who's also a social worker, about the podcast. So what jump started all of this, outside of the support of my family and my closest friends, was a teacher. You see why I had to do Teacher Appreciation Week? It was a teacher. A teacher. And so, they had enough empathy for me. But what happened to me was, prior to this, me being in Illinois now, which leads into Child C, there were a couple of things that happened to my family, which prompted us to move to St. Louis. I hope you guys are following me. If you're not, let me know. So I lived in two cities. I originally lived in St. Louis, left St. Louis, moved to Chicago. From Chicago, I moved to Central Illinois. From Central Illinois, I wound up moving back to St. Louis. Okay. So back in St. Louis, back before we wound up going to St. Louis years ago. And I want you to remember this for next week because this leads directly into Child C with having empathy and teachers and being kind to people. It all plays out with Child C. We were trying to decide if we wanted to move to St. Louis or not. And I'm going to share with you what kept happening to me because I was the one who didn't want to move to St. Louis because I had already lived there before and I just didn't want to go back. And my husband wanted to live in St. Louis. And so I wanted to stay in Illinois. Illinois is closer to Ohio anyway, and Ohio is home for me. So, excuse me. I had never. I don't remember. Some of you are my classmates. If you remember seeing a lot of cardinals around, I never saw cardinals in Cleveland ever. The bird cardinal. So, and I wasn't into baseball, and I'm not into baseball now. So I wouldn't even associate a cardinal with St. Louis. Laugh at me if you want to. I don't care. It's the truth. And so I noticed a couple of things about cardinal birds. They kept coming around. They kept coming around. And it was shocking for me. And let me pause 1 second. My battery is dying on my Instagram page for Dr. Lisa 3. If you want to continue to hear the blog, you got to go over to @kidscansee ghosts. Can you? I apologize. I just forgot to charge my tablet. So it's gonna cut off in a minute. So go to the other Instagram page for me. Kids can see ghosts. Can you? So we were I noticed the cardinal bird, they were flying around quite a bit, and that was new for me. I had never seen cardinal birds, and I was like, whatever, whatever, whatever. And so then my a couple weeks later, my husband told me. He said, "Well, hello, the St. Louis Cardinals." And I'm like, "Oh, that's interesting that cardinal birds are flying around and we're trying to decide whether or not we want to move to St. Louis. I wonder if there's an association." And you just, I don't know, you just don't, I don't necessarily think like that, like there could be an association. So anyway, one day my middle daughter was a baby, and I think she was sleeping, if I can recall. And I had said, "I'm gonna pray about it. If he wants to go, if he wants to go to, St. Louis, I gotta pray about it because I already live there, so I really don't want to move to St. Louis." So I did. I prayed about it long and hard. So God is my witness. Probably, it may have been a few days to a week later, I am sitting in the kitchen facing, like I am now, facing our door, our sliding glass doors to our deck. And a cardinal bird sits right in front of me on the deck, looking at me from the window, looking at me through the window. And I'm just looking at it. And it didn't fly away, it was just looking at me through the window. And so I said to myself, well, I ask for a sign, and there it is. There's a cardinal bird sitting right in front of me. So I told my husband, I think that's the sign that I asked for, that we need to move to St. Louis. Child C talked to me about that moment. And I never told Child C or any of the kids about that moment. As a matter of fact, I recall not even remembering that happened until I encountered Child C. Child C also told me about how kind people were to me and how I was supposed to be in St. Louis. I'll just tell you, like the psychic kid. I used to call Child C the psychic kid. This kid knew things like that. And so Child C was the one that told me the cardinal was your angel who heard you in your prayer say that to God that you needed a sign to move to St. Louis. Because I didn't want to do it. I was against it. I was against it. And so you know how it goes. We wound up moving to St. Louis. And when Child C mentioned to me that that was, an angel, and it was bring your kindness, you're always going to be in different places because you have to bring that knowledge, and your knowledge meaning psych ability, so I'm psychologically driven, or everything I learned and get my doctorate and on internships, just collectively everything, you have to take that to other kids because that's your job, and that's what God says is your job. So that's what brought us to St. Louis. The day that the cardinal bird landed and looked at me through the glass sliding doors, I said, yep, we have to go. So we literally sold our house and went to St. Louis, and I found out I was pregnant again, which was a surprise. So, Child C also knew a lot about that baby who happened to be a boy, my last baby. So, Child C, when I introduce this kid to you next week, I mean, it went as far as me showing this kid a picture of my son, and I never do that. And this kid begged me to see a picture of my son. There were things that this kid said about my son, things that this kid said about my girls. Child B's mother also said some things about my girls, in particular my oldest child. I guess I could tell you about that today before we end, but Child C was instrumental in telling me a lot about the things that I guess were mentioned to this kid from angels around me. So there's a lot to say about, Child C. So when I introduced Child C, you know that it came from, a place of, empathy, kindness, the different things that I talked about, and most importantly, the cardinal bird. Remember the cardinals. And I actually talked about cardinals before. And some of you actually have heard these kind of things before that people tell you about cardinals because some of you have written to me and said, I heard about cardinals. I know, I've heard people say that, cardinals are angels and, So a lot of the kids did tell me that about cardinals. I told you last week they also talked about crows, but Child C specifically talked about cardinals from the standpoint of what happened to me and why I was supposed to be in St. Louis and why I wouldn't stay in St. Louis, which actually did happen. So there's a lot to unpack with Child C as well. I'll tell you about Child B's and mother in a minute, but this is this week was definitely dedicated to teachers, Teacher Appreciation Week. So just know from me to you to all of the teachers that have been integral in my life, cutting my words off, I'm sorry. I really appreciate you and thank you for everything that you've done for me, even through this last position that I had last year. So I really appreciate it. Child B's mother told me different things about my kids, and I'll just share with you my oldest child. What was said about my oldest child, and then what I'm gonna do is save some of it for next week because Child C, through all of the experiences of seeing ghosts, talked to me about mostly my son, which is interesting, very interesting, and how my son and I would interact with each other. And then after Child C, there were other children who talked to me about my son as well and the relationship that I have or was going to have with my son when I was pregnant. Child B's mother talked about my oldest child, who at the time was probably in high school when I met, or close to high school when I met Child B. And Child B's mother would receive, I don't know sometimes who Child, let me just say, I don't know sometimes who Child B's mother would get messages from, but I know she was very prayerful and she could actually see ghosts. So she knew the difference between like a dark angel and, God's angel, because she would tell me not all white angels are God's angels. And so she would know the difference. And she had been seeing ghosts, since she was a kid. So she understood, what it was like, but also how to differentiate between, different entities she would see. So she would always talk about how my angels would talk to her and tell her different things. For example, she would tell me that there was a demon that lived across the street from me in another house. And she would tell me, when you pull up, it's watching you from across the street, things like that. Which the funny thing was, I used to always look back at the house when I would pull in the driveway and I would think about what she said and I would kind of go, now, which one's looking at me from what window? But I couldn't see. So it was just kind of funny to me. But anyway, she would talk about my oldest daughter and she would say she would be very successful, but they're saying watch her because over time she could be heavily influenced by other religions and she needed to be grounded in Jesus Christ. That's what she was saying. So the angel, she said, would gather around her when she would tell me stuff and nod, like, yes, tell her to watch her oldest daughter. And about how she would be very, they were telling her, and she said it was all God's angels. Obviously, again, I don't see ghosts, so I don't know, but this was all according to Child B's mother, that not only to watch her religiously, but she'll be very successful, and so she will help a lot of people, just like you have. And so she has a helping spirit, although she doesn't see it. And to this day, she claims that she doesn't. But my daughter is going to probably help a lot of people. She's on her way to apply to law school. So in law, you have the power to either hurt people or help people. I guess that's every field. So she is my kid, so she better go help people. And that's the way I see it. So I give you more information next week about Child C. We will officially introduce another nebulous child. Woohoo! I have a bunch of them. I can go all the way to Z. So you'll have me for a long time doing this. So if you have any questions, make sure you ask me. I will find my voice before next week. And until then, you guys be safe. Take care of yourselves. And I will see you soon. You're very welcome. Have a good day.